Sachin, please come and take it over. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Sudhir. It's a most tough challenge. It's the most challenging test, I would say, to speak at the last. Everything has been said. You people are all exhausted. Saturday evening almost. Still, though I was carrying a presentation which was prepared by my team, purposefully I'm not showing it and not even discussing that. It's not worth being discussed now because right since the morning, everything has been said. So I will probably share a couple of my viewpoints. I basically come from the infrastructure industry. I have been working very closely with the government on the PPP side. What has been discussed on PPP, but I will be sharing my viewpoints. I am not very categorical about these viewpoints, but these are my learning experience over 15 to 18 years. Possibly they have some linkage with the agenda, with the context. Smart City. I won't even say that I'm a categorical votary of Smart City. There has been viewpoints on the both sides. People are talking about Smart City as real estate projects. People are talking about Smart City as infrastructure projects. I have my own definition. Probably many of you agree on that definition. What our Prime Minister is talking about, or what he has, what he even said on. Announced a week to 10 days back in Japan in Kyoto with respect to Smart City. Largely when we see Smart City, I basically see Smart City as integrated elements. I see Smart City as something to be attempted technologically. I see Smart City something which is much more larger scale which we haven't seen in this country. And I see Smart City in terms of format, a different kind of format to be attempted. When I say format, I'm basically trying to say not really purely public, not really purely private. It has to be some hybrid model. Because it is too complex. As we all almost today, after today's discussion, brainstorming discussions and brainstorming sharing of ideas, we actually surely come to the conclusion that all of us are clueless about Smart City. So we really don't know what Smart City is. But one thing is sure, it is exciting. It will have a lot of trickling effect in the country. I don't know where, how much. But it will be complicated in that. And we will probably be learning over a period of time how it will be doing this. Fourth, which is very important, which I personally feel, even as a very strong nationalist, I have very strong nationalistic feeling. Anything which we talk about or anything which we do as Smart City project has to have a very strong economic drive, which is important for the project and it is also important for the country or the region, that's for sure. Let's look at the other dimension of Smart City. When you see Smart City, it is, if you can conceive it or conceptualize it, it is what exactly? It is a horizontal development spread over a large area with vertical conclaves and possibly nerves of utilities where we bring in the technology. This is what we are talking about. Let's see from a partner point of view, who all will be party to this kind of a project? Government as an enabler facilitator, a mother developer who will be actually doing the development, a strategic player which will be bringing the technology, a utility player which will be creating infrastructure, and beyond this, an investment group, because the context right now of this special session is funding, an investment group. I purposefully said investment group, because that is a large group. And there are many more things which we don't think of. The format side, which I mentioned just in the beginning, when we talk about format, I basically trying to say how will we execute this project? I would be really categorical on that given my personal viewpoints. I personally feel these kind of large events where we are talking about so many things intermingled or embedded, surely it will be some kind of a private financing initiative or a PPP format, which is what I also said, public-private partnership. We have attempted something in Agilco for last 20 years. We started in power and telecom. We have matured and saturated in roads surely with some good success. We are talking about PPP in urban infra and urban transportation space, again with a mix of success and failure. But one thing is very clear, Smart City has to be attempted surely in some kind of a PPP format or some kind of a hybrid format, which is not purely private, and it is not purely government, because government's objectives, priorities is surely not Smart City. That's for sure, even from the funding point of view, and this should never be, given the social economic context of our country. I'm clear on that. Looking for, when we say that it has to be a PPP format, what all are we looking from a project? Since we are advisors of the government, and we also very closely work with private sector in terms of motivating the marketing projects. Projects needs to be viable, but there has to be something beyond viability of a project. Project needs to be marketable. Project needs to be attractive. When I say attractive, commercially attractive. So we just mentioned about IRRs. The business community see a project from an IRR point of view. And what he even mentioned, which is he rightly said, PPP project perspective has to be seen from the business perspective of a private partner. He is not coming to you for a charity. No one comes for your charity. If he is talking about 18 to 22% of IRR, that is his opportunity. Let's be very clear on that. And third aspect is bankability, which is again very equally important element to any PPP project. But when we say bankability, unfortunately, which also has been my experience, I'm very sure many of you are coming from the government and banking sector too. We see bankability aspect of the project only from bank. We actually relate bankability to only bank. The funding of a project is not only bank, it is much beyond the bank. And let's try to see who all are there from the funding point of view. And we have been discussing, attempting in this country. We start with bank and FI. We have private equity players and FDI. We have great need of pension funds. We are talking about REITs now. We have HNIs who are potential sources. We have end user investors even as potential sources of funds. But we need to be very clear when we talk about bankability of the aspect, we need to address the concern of all these investor base, and they are not all the same. The way a bank looks at a project is very different from the way a PE looks at a project, or a REITs look at a project, or an individual investor like any one of us look at a project. So we need to incorporate those things, and that's a challenge before us. We do talk about model concession agreement in this country. It has been a great job. I don't want to be unnecessarily negative to it, but we need to really be very dynamic on those aspects. We are still clinging to the models which are still very old. We are not really dynamic in terms of even changing our model concession agreements or model draft agreements. That's very important. Further, from the funding aspect of the project. When we talk about PPP, I'm just trying to really emphasize one aspect which probably many of you will appreciate. PPP project funding basically relates to, there is a very typical financial world called project finance. Unfortunately, in our country, there are in fact two P's which are none of us understand in this country. When I say understand, means real appreciation or real execution. One is project finance and another is project management. It's very unfortunate about all of us as Indians that we really don't appreciate what exactly is project finance and what is project management. And that's a problem with respect to any development in this country, both from funding point of view and even implementation point of view. We do appreciate developments in Dubai or any other Western world. We should really appreciate the point that these people really understand project management. That's why their developments are community developments. Coming to the funding aspect, we have been talking about PPP almost last 30 years, but we haven't really appreciated and even implemented project finance. And when I say project finance, I'm very clear, I'm very sure there will be many other people who will support that idea. When we say project finance, this country's banking system, this country's financial system, and I'm also part of this country, doesn't really require project finance, doesn't really support project finance, which is non-recourse based financing. If a project is taken to a bank to get financed, we actually talk, we don't give loan to a project or to on the strength of the project. We actually give loan on the balance sheet strength of the promoter or the corporate guarantee of the promoter. And that is the most unfortunate part. We do talk conceptually many, many more very refined stuff, but in terms of implementation aspect, we are much, much more backward. We really, really need to work on that aspect. Finally, when we talk about, again, I am further taking you on the documentation aspect of PPP, which is because that's again very important. It gets reflected again on the challenges and how we do need to address those challenges. First, our documentation, which we typically call it as tender documents in very normal parlance or RFP in our parlance, or a typical draft concession agreement or a draft management contract or a draft development contract. It needs to be robust, we all know that. But I personally feel from a sustainability point of view or from the efficiency point of view, it needs to be output based. I still remember almost in the morning the South NCT Commissioner Mr. Gupta said we need to be very clear that we need to be very deterrent. And he was mentioning about you have to punish two people so that 90 of the other defaulters learn from that. Put a service parameter in terms of what do you want from an operator or from a developer. Don't guide him into the aspect of how he is going to deliver it. Because once you are very clear that you are joining hand with a private party, you should be only bothered about output, what you require. That's it. Third thing which is very important to documentation is the engagement of stakeholders. And from the funding and financing point of view, engagement of stakeholder has to be from the very beginning of the project. Our problem in our country is we hire a consultant, he prepares the RFP, he somehow manages to even close that deal on behalf of the government. The concession agreement is signed, then that agreement, the signed concession agreement goes to the bank. So for him it's a surprise. And that surprise is attested when agreements are signed. So we need to engage them at a much, much earlier stage. Let's have a buy-in from a bank or a private equity player or an FDI before you think of even going ahead with the process. One more aspect which I would like to in fact share is I have just punched the fund, that's why I am having a quick look. Funding recourses to these kind of formats beyond banks is something which would be basically requiring to take care of the basic key objective of all these sources which I just mentioned. We surely need long term funds. Our country has a problem. We can't talk about any tenor which is beyond 8 to 15, I'm very sure of that. Though I'm not a hardcore banking guy, we can't talk of any tenor which is 8 to 15. We can't talk of any interest regime which is between 3 to 5. LIBOR might be 0.3, but we don't get at 3 to 5. Even after getting external commercial borrowing, our funding, end of the day, landed funding rate is around 6 to 7% after hedging risk. So we need to talk about rates in the regime of 3 to 5%. So in fact, I would be very it's a challenge on us even to get money from Japan. The MIPRES says yes, Japan has committed $35 billion. It's a great value, exciting value to hear. Japan's and we also know that their cost of fund is almost zero. Rather, Japan people pay money to keep banks, to keep money in the banks. That's a fact about Japan. But it won't be easy to bring this money to India. To get money from Japanese, it has to be a very different format. You might get some JICA funding, that's fine. We have been getting JICA funding in Bihar, GAP, DMRC, and possibly Ahmedabad Metro Rail. But getting $35 billion loan to India won't be so easy. We have to really work on these institutional frameworks. We need to be very, very clear on that. Low cost of funds is surely a requirement. We even require country level partnership, which is we also call it as sovereign wealth funds. That is something which our country requires for these kind of projects. But again, lot of homework has to be done. Not so easy as of now. And I even personally feel, don't laugh at me, we need to see how do we even bring retail investors at the project level. Somebody said to me, I take it as a positive point, real estate in India is not sold as a home, it is even sold as a product. I believe on that. Why should not it be? There is a difference between saving and investment. I think we have risen to that level that if I have a surplus, I should not really categorize that surplus as saving. I should look that saving as an investment. Why should I be only bothered about an FD if I have an investment option? So, even smart city can have a huge, we have 1.2 billion people as investors in this country, mind it. 1 rupee saved by each one of us, it is 1.2 into 1.2 billion, it's great money. And finally, which is my personal opinion, anything big which we have been talking, smart city, smart in a very big format, the only way out to really put these kind of projects on ground, it has to be in a very progressive and a gradual manner. We should attempt our present cities to be more efficient before we talk about greenfield development. And this model will take a long run. We cannot really come to a perfect solution. I do remember a couple of things which have been shared by many experts over. In fact, I think Dr. Bose said, we can't copy other examples internationally. We can't have a one smart city model for the entire India, pan-India. There cannot be a pan-India model. I really don't believe on model concession even for entire country. No. It is not the like the case. The road behavior of each and every state is very different. Every district is very different. And these are all our personal experiences. So it has to be, and it will be a very different kind of a solution which India will give to the world for smart city. So actually, the emerging nations in the other world, whether it is Africa or Southeast Asia, will learn from us. And we will also probably take time. Thank you. In fact, I won't take much of that. It's already beyond the 5 years support, I hope. I've shared my viewpoint and possibly few of you would surely agree with it. Thank you.